What is deterritorialization and reterritorialization? When you first hear about Deleuze and Guattari, one of the first things you ever hear about is deterritorialization and reterritorialization. But what is it? What things can it describe? Well, it might first help to have a basic understanding of what a territory is. To Deleuze and Guattari, structures are separated into different territories. For example, when we look at this video game, it's not just the video game in of itself, but it also has many different territories inside of the video game. Territories, for example, where certain parts of the game's code or values are stored, territories for different game components such as the score counter, or the position of a character, or even the territories of the user interface where a player can see the territories of maps, platforms, enemies, and other game elements. But if everything is a territory, how does it change over time? That's where deterritorialization comes in. When deterritorialization occurs, all of those structures spontaneously disappear. That's why it's called deterritorialization. And immediately afterwards, something amazing occurs. Boop! The system reterritorializes again, forming slightly different territories than before. But why is it important that the system deterritorializes in the first place? Why can't it just change? As you noticed earlier, territories in of themselves can't really change their structure on their own. When they deterritorialize, parts of that structure disappear, and anything can happen in between that time. That's right, literally anything. And because of that, the structures that define that thing do not restrict how the system evolves over time. What ends up happening over time, then, is that structures across lines of deterritorialization are made more and more invisible to the observer. They are integrated heavily into other parts of the apparatus. We can think about this kind of how, like, when a game is updated over time, certain parts of the code become more and more integrated, imperceptible, in the process, hooking itself up from more and more angles as it continues to deterritorialize. This can make the game over time hard to manage and understand what's going on because the old territories are just no longer there. What are some real-world examples of deterritorialization? Well, besides video games. We can look at labor unions as an example of deterritorialization. Before labor unions, power in a company was fully concentrated in the owners of a company. This led to a lot of problems for workers, like excruciatingly long work days, dangerous environments that mass-produced horrible disabilities, the exploitation of child workers, and the oppression of any attempt for workers to be treated any better. But because of all the hard fighting of many union activists across the industrial world, the power in the company was shaken and re-territorialized into a form that now includes labor unions, representing workers. While this isn't a perfect compromise by any means, it's hard to imagine a world without some rights in the workplace, an expectation that has integrated itself heavily into many people. It's important to remember, though, that there are forces that can change the tide of that power. For example, we can look at direct selling or the practice of marketing directly to consumers. It deterritorializes advertising and marketing. Think about it. Advertising is this huge structure that broadcasts the products to a wide audience. But direct selling transformed the territory of the advertiser from a big, alienated entity to an integrated form where sellers advertise a product on the scale of individuals. This has a few advantages for a company. For example, the company through its distributed model can overstep the rights of workers by treating them as contractors, making them work hundreds of hours with little pay. Additionally, the company is far less responsible for making irresponsible advertising claims because it is not often the company itself making these claims, but rather the sellers. If a company posts a notice and fires consultants who make these claims, that is all that is necessary to stay in business most times, allowing a lot of questionable advertising to get through the cracks. The distributed model allows a company to have much more direct access to the interests and values of their customers, allowing them to heavily specialize in targeting specific loyal demographics. This combination of tactics allows many of these companies to be extremely successful in the marketplace, even if you've never heard of them. Another example is colonialism. In colonialism, people from the colonizing state invade other places for resources and believe they are granted right over the land, which they reinforce with guns and violence. Instead of simply having their land as a fatherland where they got their rights from their fathers, they extend across oceans and even the world to spread this ownership of land across new territories. After all, they believe the land is their right to own. This network splits up the state into a complex system of territories to form the empire. Because they believe they have full right over this land, they reinforce themselves into a narrative, a history, to the right of the ownership, which replicates and reinforces this network. Now, the original state can own incredible amounts of land in the form of an empire. Even after the empire recedes, it can deterritorialize even further. Now it can be a set of companies influenced by these principles, who violently isolate operations of the valuable extraction of labor and resources from the original people who were there. So as you can see, deterritorialization and reterritorialization aren't too complicated. They can help explain why and how systems change over time. Instead of evolving linearly and predictably, they spread out and make systems more dispersed and difficult to isolate and trace.